All right, everyone. Welcome to another episode of Peter and Code. Thank you very much for your likes and comments and subscribes to my last video. It gave me a lot of energy to do this video today, in which we will talk about different types of architectures for your software project. In particular, I will talk about the hexagonal architecture and the onion architecture. And eventually, I will present a new architecture, which is called the explicit architecture, which combines these two different architectures, the hexagonal and the onion architecture. It's a wonderful, relatively new architecture proposed by Herberto Grasse, I think it's pronounced. He's Portuguese, and he wrote this wonderful blog article, to which I will also link below, in which he, first of all, explains the benefits of the two other architectures, so the hexagonal and the onion architecture. And then he proposes a new architecture, the explicit architecture, that combines these twos into one, and that also mixes in some domain-driven design principles, like a domain model and domain logic and so on. This architecture I use every day for my daily work. It's a great architecture if you want to build larger projects that should last for a long time. Not like 50 years, but, you know, a couple of years. Because we all know, well, if you have worked on a larger project, you know that requirements change over time, that technologies change over time, and that you have to adapt your system to these new requirements every year or every 2 years or so. So this new explicit architecture has as a main focus to keep the system open for change. So one of the key concepts of the explicit architecture is to make your technical dependencies replaceable or substitutable. So that whenever you need to, you can just rip out one technical dependency and replace it with something that matches your new business requirements again. But it's not only about the technical dependencies on the the infrastructure side, but it's also about the ways you interact with your systems. So let's say you start off a new project and you create a new Phoenix project so that you have some a template in Vue and some HTML where you can call some actions. And when you call actions, you call a controller in your Phoenix router, for example, and that then executes some actions. Well, great. You have a project now where users can use the browser on the phone or on their computer to interact with your system. But now your customer base grows and so on, and you realize that your browser version of your system, the way to interact with your system, isn't enough anymore. You also want to offer, for example, an API because you want to give your customers direct access to your system, for example. Or you want to develop an app that, again, needs to use the API. So over time, it can happen that you have to support new ways of interacting with your system. And the explicit architecture, again, makes that also very easy to add to your system so that you can very easily connect a mobile application through an API endpoint to your system, or you can add WebSockets to your system that also interacts with your system and call some business logic inside of it. So both sides, the infrastructure side, is replaceable or is open for change, but also the primary side, the interacting side of your system, should also be open for change. So, and that's the first key focus of the explicit architecture, to keep these two sides as open for change as possible. And the second focus of the explicit architecture is to separate the code that will change a lot or that can change a lot from the code that cannot or will not change as much. And the reason why you want to do that is you want to keep the effort to make any of these changes in your boundaries, in your technical dependencies, or in your interacting parts of the system. You want to keep that effort to change it as small as possible. And in order to do that, you need to separate all the code that would need to change if you were to change something in the boundaries from the code that should not change when you change something in your boundaries. So let's say that you have a Phoenix project and you wrote a controller, and that controller has some business logic inside of it that checks any input your user gives. But now, again, if you want to add an RP controller to your system later on, you would need to copy that business logic from the controller into the RP controller as well. And then you have duplicate code, which is also a bad smell. So you would probably move that code to something that is independent of your Phoenix controller or your RP controller. And that is exactly what the explicit architecture proposes, that you move the business logic of your system into an application core that is at the heart of the whole system, and that should be as unaffected by any changes in the boundaries in the outside as possible. So then you can change the boundaries as much as you want. Your application core will always stay the same and does not need to change if you react to new business requirements, like, for example, use new technical dependencies or offer new ways to interact with your system. But all that has been quite conceptual and abstract for now. So let's just dive into the first architecture, the hexagonal architecture, and I hope this will become much more concrete for you then. All right, so this is an overview of the first architecture, the hexagonal architecture. And you see in here already a couple of points that I explained earlier. So on the left side, you have the interacting parts of your system, so the parts that interact with your system. And on the right side, you have the technical dependencies or the infrastructure parts of your system. So on the left side, for example, you have a view controller and RP controller. And on the right side, you have some Active Postgres and Bamboo that sends some email, and HTTP poison, a dependency also that makes for you some HTTP requests. So there are two elements of the hexagonal architecture that you should know. One of them is the port and the other one is the adapter. So the port is a consumer agnostic entry exit point to your system that only defines some logic, some behavior that you can expect at that entry or exit point. And the second element is the adapter, and that is actually an implementation of that interface. So when your port says, for example, this entry exit point allows you to set a user's age with a username and a new age, then that is the definition of that entry exit point. And then your adapter would be an implementation of that definition. So you would actually have a module with a function that would set the user age. And ports and adapters are a bit different on the left than on the right. On the left, again, you would have a port that defines a function that you can use. So for example, this port over here could say, well, I represent the use case, set the age or set a new age of a user. And I represent that use case and I offer for that a function which is set new age with a user ID and a new age parameter. So that's just a definition. Then you would have an adapter also in your application side that then would offer that function and execute some business logic to set that user's age. And that is how a port and adapter would work on the left side. So for the interacting adapter. Because now any controller here or mixed task, for example, can just call that function setUserAge with the appropriate parameters and execute the business logic that it wants to execute. Now, if you want to replace the view controller with an RP controller, you can just use the same port and the same adapter, so the same implementation of your interface. And the RP controller can also just call the setUserAge function and you're done. You have replaced the view controller with the RP controller, at least in terms of which business logic it is calling. Now on the right side, it's a bit more tricky. The port is part of your system. So for example, with the HTTP poison library over here, you yourself would write an interface, a definition of the functionality that you can expect from that technical dependency. And then you would use the implementation of the HTTP poison library in this case to actually execute that functionality. So here you would have an interface that has, let's say, a couple of callbacks. A callback would be post with two parameters and would be get with two parameters. And this interface you can then know about or you can use in the rest of your system. So whenever anything inside your business logic needs to call the HTTP poison library, it can rely on the fact that you have an interface here that specifies what the HTTP Poison library or any other library at this point can offer to you. So it offers a post function and it offers a get function, for example. And you can just use that in your business logic. And the actual implementation of the post and get function then lies inside the library. Or maybe if you need to change the library for a library that has different functions, you would put an adapter in between. So you would actually implement this yourself. So you would have a module that offers a get and a post function with certain parameters. And that again itself then calls the new dependency. So that if you ever replace the HTTP Poison library, you don't need to do anything else in your business logic. Now let's look at the two requirements of the architecture again. One of them is it should be open for change. So you can see that by offering ports to the other parts, to the interacting or being interacted parts of your system, by offering a port here, you decoupled your system from any changes in these parts. So if we replace a view controller with an RP controller, for example, the rest of your system doesn't need to change, or a port doesn't need to change, because it doesn't care what is calling it. And on the other side, if we have to replace HTTP Poison, for example, with something different, also our inner core or our application core doesn't need to change, because all we need to do is to replace a couple of calls from our adapter to the new library, and that's it. The rest of our application core doesn't need to know about it. So this way you're much more open for change in the system. And the second key factor here was to, I call it, prevent leakage of business logic. So in here in the application core, you have your business logic, you have your use cases and so on, and that should not leak into these parts of your system. So for example, if you have a view controller on the left, this view controller itself should not hold any business logic. So it should not check, for example, whether a user is older than 18 or not. Because if it would have that business logic and we would want to replace it with an RP controller, we would also have to copy all that business logic in there. And then if you want to add something else like a mixed task, then we also have to copy the code in there. So that's not what you want. You don't want to have your business logic be dependent on the interacting part, because the interacting part can change, but your business logic should not change and probably will not change. Again, this was a bit less abstract, I hope, but still abstract. And as I said, I will write some Elixir code in the end so that you actually understand what this means for your Elixir code. But just to sum it up, this has been the hexagonal architecture. The main feature here is to move any changing parts, any interacting parts, or any dependencies to the outside of your system. So outside from your inner business logic to the outside boundaries. In this way, your business logic inside does not change or does not need to change whenever you change anything in the outside. So when you change, for example, the way you interact with your system, or whether you change the way how your system interacts with other systems, with other dependencies, for example. But this is, I think, enough now for the hexagonal architecture. So let's just quickly jump over to the onion architecture, which explains how you can structure your application inside this black box here, which I only call business logic. So that's where the onion architecture comes in, which I will explain next. All right, and this is the onion architecture. Let me quickly give you some context. In the hexagonal architecture, we stopped at the boundaries of this hexagon, and inside here, everything was a black box. So now the onion architecture extends that and explains how you can structure your system inside your business logic, inside your application core, in order to also be able to change it in the future, to be able to adapt to your new business requirements in your future. And there are a couple of layers that I will just go through here. So the outermost layer is the application service layer. And in here, you will write your application services that are like service classes or service modules that then offer the port, the interface to the outside world, to the boundaries. So you can see you have an application service, and that application service could be called set user age, for example. And that offers a function set user age with a user ID and the new age. And it offers this to the outside boundaries, like the view controller, that then can use that in order to execute some business logic in here. So these application services will most likely be your entry point to the application core. The application services usually do some managing of the flow. So they usually fetch some data from your repository. They fetch entities, and then they make these entities do something, like they execute, for example, some functions on these entities, and then most likely also communicate again with the repository to store the change of that entity. An entity like a user, for example, would be a domain model of your system. So if you don't know what a domain model is, I would recommend to you to go to Herbertus Grasse's article about DDD, which I will also link to in the comments below, in the description below. So let me just shortly summarize what a domain model is. A domain model holds all the business logic that applies to a certain entity or value object of your system. So for example, a user with all its data, like name, email, age, for example, would be an entity because it has its own ID. If it doesn't have an own ID, it's called a value object because it is an object that simply holds a value. Like money, for example, is always a good example for a value object because 1 euro doesn't have an identity. So if you have a money object or a struct, it only holds a value, like one, for example. So you have entities and value objects. And a domain model class, a module, would then hold all the business logic that applies to that entity or value object. And the domain model also makes sure that the state of your entity or value object is always correct according to your business rules. So for example, if you have money as a value object and you apply a subtraction to it, so you add -2 euros to yourself, it would check, well, I cannot do that because 1 euro minus 2 euros would be -1 euro, which is an invalid state and that I cannot allow. So in that case, your domain model always checks that if you apply changes to your entity or your value object, that these changes are valid, and also that the state you will get out of that change is a valid state as well. And one last element I would like to explain is the domain service. The domain service is used when you have domain logic or business logic that applies to multiple domain models. So if you have two entities, two value objects, or one entity and a value object, whatnot, and you want to apply a change to one of them, or to both, then you would need a domain service to coordinate that change. So for example, you have an account and you have a money value object, and you want to add that money object, that money value object to that account. So you would get the account, you would produce the money value object, and then you would give both to a domain service that then would check for domain logic that applies for that transaction, for that behavior, so to say. So for example, you could check that your account is not blocked or is allowed to receive transactions. And if it's not, then you would give back an error. But if it is allowed to receive money, then you would apply the money value object to the account and get the new account struck back, the new state of the account, and give that back to the application service. So you see that whenever you have multiple domain models that need to interact to satisfy your use case, then you would most likely need a domain service that takes care of that for you. So these are all the elements that you need to know about the Onion architecture. One last key factor though, one last key rule in the Onion architecture is that the dependency between these elements always goes from outside to inside. So only outside elements are allowed to depend on inside elements, and not the other way around. So only an application service is allowed to call a domain service, for example. A domain model is not allowed to call a domain service. So you see, the dependency always goes from outside to inside. And eventually, then you end up with a domain model, which is at the very core of your application, and that should not have any dependency on anything else. This is like a strict rule. I said it's in a strict way. In practice, it's not as strictly enforced, but it's always a trade-off, and you have to be very careful about this. Because let's say your domain model relies on something outside of your system. Well, then if you need to change that thing outside of your system, you need to change your domain model, you need to change your domain service, probably you need to change your application service maybe as well. And then you would also need to change your outside things, your interacting parts as well. So the further in you go into your application core, the fewer dependencies you want to have. So the application service might have a dependency on the API service, repository, and a domain service. But then the domain service itself only has a dependency on these two domain objects, domain models. And the domain models themselves don't have any dependency to anything outside. In this way, you keep your most stable logic, your most stable code in the very inner, in the most inner region of your application. Like you protect it from the changes in the outside world, basically. All right, and this has been the Onion architecture. Now you learned how you can structure your code inside your hexagon to keep it also stable in the core so that you don't need to change it when anything changes around it. But also offer the APIs, the protocols, the ports to the outside world so that they can connect to your system. One last thing, Herberto Grassi put these two things together in which he called the explicit architecture. It is much more complex than what I explained here now. So I will just quickly show you this diagram, which is an overview of everything he talks about in the explicit architecture. But the basics you just learned, which is the hexagon architecture with the dependencies outside on the right side, so the driven adapters outside of the hexagon, and the interacting parts of your system on the left side that connect to your system through ports or through interfaces. And then inside your hexagon, you have the onion architecture with the application layer that holds the application services, and then the domain layer, which holds the domain services and the domain model. And all this and more you can read in the wonderful article DDD, Hexagonal, Onion, Clean, CQRS, whatever, how I put it all together, which I will link to as well. And there are also many more topics that Herberto wrote about in what is called the Software Architecture Chronicles that also cover older architectural designs, and then eventually ends up in his own proposal, which is called the explicit architecture. So these have been the three architectures that I wanted to talk about: the hexagonal, the onion, and eventually the explicit architecture. During the video, I promised you to write some Elixir code to show you how you can implement this yourself in your own project. But I realized that this video is already way too long and also way too complex. So I made the decision to cut the video here. And this will be the first part, like the theoretical part. And I will make a second video about how to implement the explicit architecture in your own Elixir project. I will most likely publish these videos at the same time. So if you're done here now, you can just move over to the second part of it and enjoy to see me coding the whole explicit architecture in a new project. So this is the end of the first video. Thank you very much for staying with me. I hope you learned a lot. We can communicate on Twitter if you want, at Peter and Code, or on the Elixir forum. I made a thread, which I also put in the show notes in the description below. Or just give me a thumbs up and subscribe here, as people say on YouTube, and maybe leave a nice comment. Or not a nice comment, I also like to receive constructive but negative feedback. Well, thank you very much for staying with me. Stay healthy. I see you in the second part in just a minute. Bye.